Welcome to Mr. 96's Pop Reviews. My name is Mr. 96. Once again, it's that time of year where I look over the worst that popular music had to offer. But unlike previous years, this year is going to be a bit different in that 2019 saw some significant improvement. To be fair though, 2018 was so awful that pop music had nowhere to go but up, but as far as this video is concerned, most of the improvement came in the quantity of bad songs or relative lack thereof. As a whole, 2019 was an alright year for the charts. After the Death Valley of an era that was 2016 to 2018, this year was a goddamn breath of fresh air. While most of the good music from 2019 didn't necessarily blow my mind, there weren't many bad songs that I can name off the top of my head either. Unlike last year, I'm not really going to be as angry or outraged over these entries, save for a few of them. Really, outside of the 10 songs I chose for this list, the worst it got was merely bad, but not horrible. I wouldn't necessarily say it was a good year, like say 2015, but it was a fine year where most songs were either good enough or only kinda bad. Here are the guidelines. To be eligible for my list, the song must have charted in the top 60 of the Billboard Hot 100 sometime from January to November 2019, and its release date cannot be later than August of 2019. Also, if the song was released before September 2018, it cannot be on the 2018 Year in Hot 100. But more importantly, this list is completely subjective. All these choices are my personal opinion, meaning you have every right to disagree with me. So I will respect your opinion as long as you respect mine. And for those new to my channel, know that I love pop music, meaning I also plan to make a top 10 best hit songs list later this month, so do not mistake me for a hater. Mr. 69 will be on piano as we finally take a look at the top 10 worst hit songs of 2019. Music is an artistic statement. So just like how a bad lyric can ruin a song, a bad title can set an awful tone that's hard to overcome. Notable examples include You're Having My Baby, Chicken Noodle Soup, and who can forget the classic Disco Tits? An old saying goes, you never get a second chance to make a first impression. So you tell me, if the artists of this next song don't bother to sound like they care, why should I? 'Cause I don't care when I'm with my baby, yeah. All the bad things disappear. I'm not gonna spend too much time on this one. It's exactly like the title implies in that it's a lazy, half-assed song that became insanely popular on Star Power alone. The song is supposedly about how Ed and Justin don't fit in at a party, but they don't care as long as they have their ladies beside them. Nothing too complex. So why is Justin Bieber here? We at a party we don't wanna be at. What does Justin Bieber's flavorless voice add that Ed Sheeran couldn't have easily done on his own? I've often joked to myself that nobody makes solo hits anymore, but at least most collaborations have a musical reason behind them. The only reason it's not a solo song is because it's part of Ed Sheeran's collaborations album, so even though it clearly didn't warrant a guest feature, he was basically forced to recruit someone. Seriously, I can totally envision what the record label said when making this. I'm at a party I don't wanna be at. And I don't ever wear a suit and tie. God damn it, Ed. The collaborations album is due in 3 days and we need a lead single. Look, we don't have time to revise it or change the sound, so we'll just get some bland vanilla artist who can fill in some space. Bieber, how about Bieber? We good? We good. All right, Ed, see you on Monday. 'Cause I don't care. Honestly, this goofy, happy-go-lucky attitude is pretty obnoxious. The music essentially stays the same from beginning to end outside of the bridge, and the production sounds like a cheap reggae instrumental some hack made on GarageBand. Is what I would say if said hack were not legendary producer Max Martin. Seriously? He must really be overworked if he was gonna phone it in this badly. I don't like nobody but who's like you're the only one here. Some might argue the laid-back atmosphere enhances the song's message, but to me, it's condescending. And not in the way they probably intended. Instead of looking down on the snobs at the party they're describing, these guys are looking down on you, the listener, for continuing to buy this crap. This was a calculated move. The music's insultingly basic and undercooked, but since it sounds musically competent enough to resemble a song, casual listeners won't complain. Basically, they turned in a rough draft of an essay, and the professor let them skip the final exam. What sucks the most is that I have to hear this a million times on every radio station because no way pop radio lets this fall off the face of the earth when hip-hop is dominant. When the field is weak, pop radio will cling on to whatever crap they can get. Don't expect this to be the last example I talk about. These top 10 videos, I spend weeks to months figuring out which songs to pick, and for the longest time, I really wanted to put No Guidance on this list. Oh yeah, I was totally ready to. Chris Brown is still a subpar artist, and this song has all the passion and energy of me in biology class. But after listening to it multiple times, it's not the worst song in the world. Don't get me wrong, it's still not good, but the instrumental at least has this sleep-inducing appeal I can sort of get. Chris Brown can't sing, but it's far from the most offensive thing he's ever made. A boring hip-hop song is one thing, but at least there's some discernible flavor I can understand. If you want a boring song I have absolutely no use for, that would be boring Christian music.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough.
Before I talk about the song, I would like to clarify that I have nothing against music about faith. While I may not be religious, I have no problem with songs about believing in a greater power. In fact, I find that a wonderful sentiment, and if this song worked for you, more power to you. I review music, so when I say this is a bad song, understand that I'm not criticizing the message. My real issue is that the music sounds dull as shit.
You say
individually, the piano riff isn't that bad, but the issue is that it just repeats over and over, non-stop. At least when Adele releases piano ballads, the notes sound complex and varied enough to where you can distinguish the verse from the pre-chorus and so on. You know, I used to complain heavily about trap music, but in the last 2 years, I've mostly softened on that stance. Unfortunately, pop radio can't seem to get on board and is willing to push a Christian act just to keep talented people like DaBaby off the airwaves. Oh god, Adele hasn't released anything in years, and Sam Smith is doing EDM music! We need to find her substitute now! Okay, Adele sings ballads, ballads often have pianos. What genre makes piano ballads? Religious music! Let's see what's hot in the Christian charts. That was a thing in the early 90s. People love the 90s, right?
The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me.
Lyrically, it's not very subtle about its religiousness when the lyrics on Genius.com explicitly spell you with a capital Y. But that's sort of the problem. Musically, it's too subtle, but lyrically, it's too heavy-handed. While I've said I don't like Christian music, I can at least acknowledge it has a place in this world. If you like it, that's totally great. But keep it where it belongs, that being the Christian charts, or the goddamn church.
You say I'm
I have to believe the music industry is actively forcing this down our throats, not because the general population actually likes this, right? Or is our socio-political climate that bad to where people are actively flocking to worship music? Either way, whoever's responsible for pushing this song to stardom is pretty shameless. Hell, I don't even think the Church of Saros pushes their agenda that much. Look, I'm sure Lauren Daigle is a nice person, but this just isn't the kind of song that belongs in the Hot 100, and the thought of this eventually becoming a Kidz Bop song makes my skin crawl. Look, I know Kidz Bop ruins every hit song, but considering how popular this one has gotten, I do not want a worship jam's comeback. Oh yeah, that was a thing. This next song, you have to understand that this concept was pretty much dead on arrival. But even when you put aside the conceptual mess, the execution is a whole nother thing entirely.
I've cheated and I've lied, I've broke down and I've cried.
Yeah, I have a feeling that plenty of other people will include this in their worst songs videos, but I want to explain exactly why this bugs the hell out of me. Marshmello is arguably the most generic producer that's popular. He's so bland, he's starting to make David Guetta sound like Skrillex.
Known to be crazy, known to be wild.
So this song is a country EDM ballad. On paper, that already sounds like a disaster waiting to happen, but not in the way you think. You see, country and electronic dance music don't exactly have a great history.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Cousin I do.
However, this song has the opposite problem in that it's boring as f***.
You saw it through my pain.
Even if you're the most diehard Kane Brown fan, I don't see how anyone can sit through this whole thing when there's barely anything playing in the background. And when the music instrumental does start to kick in, oh my.
I got one thing right, you.
Ugh, what the f*** kind of drop was that? It sounds less like country and more like mid-2000s post-grunge with some twang sprinkled in. Now that I think about it, doesn't this part sound familiar to you?
Cause I've been wrong about a million times, but I got one thing right.
No, that means I'll have to leave you.
Yeah, the drop has a similar structure to the one in Happier, yet it somehow sounds infinitely worse. I was always lukewarm on Happier, but this just sounds like butt-ugly garbage. It's barely country, and it's barely EDM, so who the hell was asking for this?
I've been at the wrong place at the wrong time.
You know what? Forget about Happier. This solemn vibe actually reminds me of another song by Marshmello.
And I've been silent for so long.
For those who don't know, I actually really like Silence by Marshmello featuring Khalid. Like One Thing Right, this one is also a slow ballad sung by a deep voice singer. So why do I like one, yet hate the other? When it comes to the song's vibe, there's a huge difference between the two. Khalid is an R&B singer. Kane Brown is country.
I've been wrong about a million times.
One Thing Right tries to be all grounded and moody in its atmosphere, which works well for R&B, but not for something like country. Then again, country has sounded artificial for a long time now, but that's beside the point, as this definitely did not get One Thing Right. Well, Marshmello, at least you still have Silence, right? I mean, it's not like there's a better EDM song with Khalid out there.
It won't keep us apart.
Oh wait, Martin Garrix made a similar song with Khalid that's actually way better. So you know what, Marshmello? I do have no use for you. So either make better music, or just fade into obscurity. Song on this list, I'm doing so because the song is bad, not the artist necessarily. A good artist can make a bad song, just like how a bad artist can make a good song. Oftentimes, I like to keep my opinions close to my chest so that my top 10 worst and best lists become more unpredictable, but sometimes a song is just so blatantly awful, I have to talk about it immediately. For the record, the fact that this is number 7 is merely a coincidence. I don't think I heard a single bad song from Ariana Grande during her first two albums, but my, have things changed. Don't get me wrong, when she's on her game, she's still capable of making great music, but when looking at her Thank You Next album, she left a lot to be desired. In this song, she's trying to do some brag rap hip hop shtick, but coming from her, it just doesn't work at all. It took me years to accept Ariana Grande as a fully grown adult woman, but this is the kind of barrier I don't think I'll ever cross. First off, brag rap songs have a certain degree of intimidation factor that makes listeners envious of them, and Ariana Grande is the least intimidating person you could put in that role.
Whoever said money can solve your problems must not have had enough money to solve them.
When she brags about having money, it's not like how most rappers describe their journey from rags to riches. No, it's just a former child actress bragging about her wealth while everyone else doesn't get any. At least that's how it comes off.
You like my hair? Gee, thanks. Just put it.
Also, there's the whole thing about cultural appropriation and whatnot, but I'm not gonna open that can of worms here. I briefly touched on that topic when I reviewed the song last February, so if you want my opinion on that, I'll put a link to my 7 Rings video below. The strange thing is that whenever I listen to the first 2/3 of the song, it's not the worst song ever, but then Ariana has a rap bridge reminding me why I hated this to begin with. I'm sorry, but who told Ariana Grande that she was an MC? But more importantly, who thought it was a smart idea for 5-foot Ariana Grande to invoke actual gangster rap? I doubt a majority of her fanbase even knows who Biggie Smalls is, so as far as they know, her saying "Give me the loot" is just harmless rich white girl flexing that has nothing to do with using firearms to violently rob women like in the song she's ripping on. 7 Rings is a mess of a train wreck. It's poorly conceived, lacks any kind of self-awareness, and tries to boast about things other artists have done better. It's easily the worst song from Thank You Next, and I'm saying this as someone who found "Break Up With Your Girlfriend, I'm Bored" slightly tolerable. Think about it. Christian song before, whenever I review a song with a supposedly positive message, I always try to remind people that a good message and a good song are two very different things. For the last number of years, the VMAs has had this award called Video for Good, which is given to music videos with positive social messages. While I'm not a fan of the VMAs in general, I couldn't help but double take when I noticed one particular song that got nominated. What?
I I've tasted blood and it is sweet.
One ideal that I've always been consistent in, no matter the medium, is that good intentions do not make the art. Execution is the deal breaker. You can have the greatest ideas in the world, but none of that means shit if you can't convey those ideas properly. How else do you think we got Fire Emblem Fates? You want to make a song calling out sexist assholes? I'm all for it. But before you worry about getting your message across, how about making sure your song sounds finished first? The sound mixing in the chorus is absolute garbage. The vocals and instrumental are both cranked to max volume, audio spikes and all, to where they both bleed into each other to become indistinguishable noise. But even disregarding the production issues, Halsey's singing is so over the top, she sounds less like an oppressed victim of sexism and more like a 9-year-old throwing a tantrum after getting his Xbox taken away. I wasn't the biggest fan of her hit song Without Me, but at least that song managed to set a somber tone consistent with its premise. With Nightmare, she's trying to sound dangerously angry, yet I just can't buy it for a second. Just a nitpick, but am I the only person who's put off by the way Halsey pronounces words?
Come on, little lady, give us a smile.
Hold on, did she just say 80? Like 80 as in Edelgard? Okay, according to Genius.com, the word she meant to say was lady. Huh, could have fooled me. Honestly, I kind of wish she said 80, which would give the song an entirely different meaning. But no, it's just another moody Halsey track.
Come on, little lady, give us a smile. No, I ain't got nothing to smile about.
What makes this song unenjoyable, in my opinion, is that it's so self-serious without any semblance of self-awareness. It's the kind of song in which you can tell she thought she was making the most provocative song ever. But unlike Tommy Wiseau in The Room, Halsey's passion project has no inkling of ironic hilarity.
No sweet dream, but I'm a hell of a night.
Truer words have never been spoken. May this hell be forgotten as an embarrassing blip in your discography. I said before that I used to hate trap music when I started this channel, but after a few years, I began to see the appeal. Still doesn't stop mainstream rap fans from lashing out at me with racist YouTube comments, but then again, what will? But seriously, if you're going to accuse me of being biased towards certain genres, hip-hop is not even close to being my least favorite. No, if there's a musical genre that makes me cautious every time I listen to it, it's folk music. Yeah, most of the popular ones just don't do it for me. I love plenty of songs with an acoustic guitar, but the folk songs that become hits are often sung by condescending white dudes over what's likely to be bland and empty production. But more importantly, all of those bad ones are just flat out boring. However, it's not just the Americans and Brits who are guilty of that. Instead, let's head down to the nation of Australia.
I look up from the ground to see your sad and teary eyes. You look
This man right here goes by the name of Dean Lewis. The song is about how Dean's friends are trying to cheer him up after a sad, tough breakup. According to the man himself, Be Alright is supposed to be a song of hope, showing that even through tough times, there's light at the end of the tunnel. But I don't feel hopeful. How could I when this funeral music is playing?
I know you love her, but it's over, mate. It doesn't matter, put the phone.
Look, I may not have been through the kind of harsh breakup he describes, but I've definitely gone through periods of pessimism, stress, and loneliness recently. Bad enough to where I needed guidance from an outside party just to keep my head straight through these hellish months of school. You'd think if there was a time for me to find some sort of meaning or relatability in this song, it would be now, but no, it just makes me more frustrated. The lyrics tell me it will be alright, but the music doesn't show that.
It's never easy to walk away, let her go.
Yeah, man, I feel so motivated right now. I can't wait to sit through another minute of this song for you to spread the depths of your gloomy undercurrent once more. The only non-depressing moment of this song is when he lets you know he's from the land down under.
You say the cigarettes on the counter weren't your friends, they were my mates.
Need to make sure everyone knows I'm from Australia. But all joking aside, even in the moments where there should be optimism, it just doesn't come through.
It's gonna hurt for a bit of time. So bottoms up, let's forget.
Wow, can you make getting drunk at the bar sound even more awkward and depressing? Maybe it's because I don't drink, but I just absolutely hate the phrase bottoms up. Whenever I hear bottoms up, this is all I can think of. I'm gonna take a wild guess and say I don't think Dean Lewis was trying to evoke Trey Songz in his melodramatic ballad. In doing research, I went and listened to this one song Dean Lewis did with Martin Garrix, and I thought it was pretty solid.
We can't go back to the way that we used to.
I still don't think his voice sounds that great, but he wasn't half bad with decent music behind him. This song just makes me want to go to bed and rethink my life. But to be fair, that's mostly the music and not the man himself. From what I can tell, Dean Lewis seems like a decent guy. It's not like I'm calling him John Mayer or something. So if by random chance he happens to be watching this video, no hard feelings, man. I just didn't like the song. Section I'm not very excited to talk about. Not because the song is bad, it is, but because the genre's fanbase can get f***ing annoying. Last year, 7 of my top 10 worst hit songs of 2018 were hip-hop, 8 if you include Him and I by Jeezy and Halsey. As a result, many people naturally assumed I hated hip-hop, but there are several problems with that assumption. 1, it's not true. 2, I've included more than a few high-profile rap songs in my Best Hit Songs of the Year videos, with some of them ranking pretty high on the list. And 3, shitty music is shitty music regardless of the genre. This year, I only included 2 hip-hop songs on this list. Not because I cared about variety or whatever, but because most of this year's bad music just so happened to not be hip-hop. And to be honest, I'm not even angry over this one. Don't get me wrong, it's awful, but I honestly can't get too mad at this because I'm just amazed as to how something like this could exist.
She told me put my heart in the bag, and nobody gets hurt.
What the hell am I listening to? It's like I'm at my middle school talent show all over again. So you're telling me this man is a professional artist? Like, I should be infuriated that he sounds like what little singing talent he had wasn't enough for the Monstars to bother stealing, but it's just so precious.
One thing my dad told me was never.
Deep, man. I'm gonna take a shot in the dark, but did Juice WRLD happen to listen to Eamon growing up?
Fuck what I said, you told me shit now.
It only makes sense. Eamon was another whiny-voiced guy who made a hit song about how his ex broke his heart, and like Juice WRLD, he also lacked the ability to realize that his diss to his ex only made him sound more desperate.
One thing my heart tells me is flex on a hoe every time there is a girl.
Sorry, I can't sit through this song with a straight face. If you're a Juice WRLD fan, please let me know how you managed to take this seriously. Okay, I'm done. I think we've got our fill. Earlier this year, someone accused me of not liking black music, all because I thought We Fly High by Jim Jones was one of the worst hit songs of 2007. Look, I'll be the first to admit that I'm not some grand expert on the history of hip-hop, but I've listened to enough rap in my life to know that Jim Jones is not a hill worth dying on. With an accusation that large, you'd think I was trashing someone like Q-Tip, Common, Mos Def, Outkast, Kendrick, or even goddamn Drake, but no, it's Jim f***ing Jones! Who cares? This will be the final hip-hop song on this list, but trust me, I bring this all up to say that no matter how respected an artist may be, anyone can make a terrible song in any genre. That's why it's finally time for me to say something I've wanted to say for many years now. You know Kanye can make bad music, right?
I think I got mixed personalities. This bitch switched up my whole mentality.
My God. Which is not Kanye, by the way. This auto-tune chorus sounds like a rejected outtake from the blooper reel of 808s and Heartbreak. Also, that rhyme I just made has more intrigue than anything else this song has to say. Apparently, Kanye and Melly are trying to say they have mixed personalities, and these unsavory alter egos are being brought out by some bitch they know. While this situation could theoretically be possible, these guys don't exactly do a great job of staying consistent with their story.
His girl, she got mixed personalities. One day she's happy, then she's mad at me.
Wait, so she has mixed personalities as well? Oh, I get it. So it's a mutually destructive relationship then. That's an interesting topic. I'd like to know more.
I'm all inside, I knock down a wall. Down. This bitch hyper needs some Adderall.
Hold on, so she's the one who needs meds? But I thought you both had mixed personalities. So shouldn't you also need to be drugged to calm down your... You see what I'm trying to say here? Really, this whole mental illness angle is starting to sound like an excuse to blame the girl for all their own problems. Whether she's completely responsible or not, these guys don't do a good job of giving a cohesive narrative.
You won't find nobody that can fuck you like I fuck you, babe. You won't find nobody that can fuck you like I fuck you, babe.
Romantic. Can't you come up with something more creative?
As my food, as my slime, as my everything.
Ugh, what the hell is that supposed to mean? That's my slime? According to Urban Dictionary, slime is the equivalent of homie, but I'm sorry, that's just stupid. It's supposedly a compliment, but it sounds more like an insult considering Melly talks about this girl like she's literal slime. Unless slime is actually supposed to be a representation of where he'll put his semen.
Say you want someone that'll love you, someone who could please you.
Holy shit, that auto-tune falsetto nearly blew out an eardrum. I'm gonna wrap this up. The production is annoying, Melly doesn't give a convincing tale, and Kanye adds nothing to this song as he didn't even produce this. Though that's actually a blessing for his sake. The last thing I'll say for YNW Melly is this. If you're really gonna blame your wrongdoings on mixed personalities, let's just say your lawyers are giving you really bad advice. Not trying to pick sides or anything, just honest feedback from a neutral party. Nostalgia can either be a means of great joy or corporate soullessness. Like many people, I absolutely hate the Disney live-action remakes. They're shameless cash grabs made to bank on the nostalgia of older fans, not because Disney actually cares about what made the source material great, but because they know ignorant casuals will pay to see anything that even somewhat resembles their childhood. Not surprisingly, this strategy continues to work, because parents apparently set no standards for what they show their children or themselves because they'll just eat any table scraps the mouse feeds them. I mean, they could have remade obscure Disney films like The Black Cauldron that could actually benefit from a modern update, but no, let's rehash the entire Disney Renaissance, even though those movies are timeless classics that still hold up to this day and display more passion and creativity than anything they've made outside of Marvel, Pixar, and their animation studio. Sorry, that was my little Disney rant, but what I'm trying to say is that nostalgia is a tool that can be used for terrible intentions. For example, remember this band from the late 2000s?
Woke up feeling like a new James Dean. Comb my hair like an old school scene.
Earlier this year, I reviewed the song Sucker by the Jonas Brothers. In there, I mentioned how I never really had a strong opinion of them, even during their Disney years. Going in, I was expecting some empty soulless filler track that would only get big off of nostalgia alone, but to my genuine surprise, Sucker was a solid enough song that stood on its own, even discounting the Jonas Brothers factor. Nah, the real song I should've been worried about was Cool, which is just 3 million pounds of lame without shame.
Woke up feeling like a new James Dean.
Now, you are not James Dean in any shape or form. The only reason you mentioned him is because everyone likes to mention him. For those who don't know, James Dean was an iconic actor from the 50s whose life was tragically cut short with only 3 credited films to his name. If we wanted to find a musical equivalent, that would be like an artist who died after only 3 studio albums. I wonder if anyone fits that description.
Hey, wait.
Oh, that's right, Kurt freaking Cobain, another rebellious personality and arguably the most influential musician of the entire 90s decade. So no matter how you slice that James Dean line, it just doesn't work because Nick Jonas is neither James Dean nor Kurt Cobain.
Lately,
ugh, this feels like an episode of a terrible sitcom where the main character tries to act cool to impress some chick. Hell, it's even more terrible than their actual sitcom. But to be fair, we haven't even gotten to the worst line.
Oh, I feel like buzzed around when I get home. Sitting there waiting like it's Game of Thrones.
Ugh. Where do I begin? First off, I don't even know the logic behind feeling like Post Malone. You two are barely in the same species. Why would you reference him?
And I'm rolling, 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 rolling. With my brothers like it's Jonas, Jonas.
Post himself referenced the Jonas Brothers in his song Better Now, so I see why they felt the need to return the favor, but why would you do so in the cheesiest song possible? Why do you feel like Post Malone when you get home? Because you win? At best, that is a stock line that can be used to describe almost any other person. And coming from someone who hates White Iverson, let me say that Post Malone is 300 times cooler than you. Try harder! Look, Joe, I know your wife is a former Game of Thrones actress, but that was terrible timing. I may not watch the show, but I do have a Twitter account, and based on how the internet has reacted to the final season, I'm pretty sure no one came out of this a winner. I don't like being unnecessarily harsh, since I don't really have any strong Jonas Brothers feelings on either side. I enjoyed Sucker well enough. Hell, I thought Only Human was their best single this year. But Cool is just a hot mess. I only hope this song becomes forgotten as an embarrassing footnote of our times. I'll be curious to see how we'll explain this to future generations.
Damn it, I'm feeling so cool.
But before we get to number one, let's go over some dishonorable mentions that just missed out on making the list. No!
Celebrate for the ones we lost, yeah. Celebrate with the ones we died, yeah.
I find it hilarious that DJ Khaled started whining about his album underperforming because he's the last person you think of as an actual artist. By the way, this song he probably had no part in making also sucks.
That's okay, cause baby, you
got it, girl, you got it.
Like I said, Chris Brown is not a good singer, and the song nearly puts me to sleep. Then again, maybe that's your fetish, so I won't judge. It tries to be emotional, but it mostly falls into the repeated reggaeton formula of lazy beats and toxic vibes. Also, no song has ever gotten better by having a remix with Ozuna. I've tried to give her the benefit of the doubt for years, but I'm just gonna say it. Bebe Rexha is not a good singer. Plus, the Chainsmokers are not the kind of group that can hide her vocal limitations. I was already hesitant about a reggaeton song sampling Informer by Snow, but Daddy Yankee decided to double down on my apprehension by making a remix with Katy Perry. Why?
Please me, baby. Turn around and just tease me, baby.
This was the shitty direct-to-DVD sequel of Finesse we didn't need, but probably deserved. Honestly, I find the song kind of annoying. It's not as bad as when I first heard it, but it still boggles my mind that Taylor would compare Twitter trolls to actual violent homophobes.
I'm speechless.
I actually like Dan and Shay for the most part. I just found this one song to be pretty stale. I guess we really are skipping the 90s retro era, as now we're just ripping off one of the greatest songs of the early 2000s. I love It Wasn't Me by Shaggy, but this reggaeton sample of it just doesn't vibe with me. But now, let us finally look over the worst this year had to offer. I have waited so long to talk about this song. When I first heard it, I knew it was going to be popular because it was just bland and shitty enough for radio to love it. Plus, it's not even the kind of shitty where it's an interesting train wreck. First listen, just a mediocre ballad, but with every ensuing replay, it only got infinitely worse. I don't know how the Brits feel about this song, but as an American who deeply appreciates the intricacies of different cultures, I need this man to go back to Scotland!
Another day bleeds into nightfall.
In years past, I would be relatively soft on boring piano ballads, but not this time. My patience has worn incredibly thin. This combines the worst of all pop music in that it's a boring piano ballad that also happens to be sung by one of the worst voices I've ever heard in pop. To explain why I feel no emotional connection to this song, let us begin with the fact that this work of poetry is about some drunk sad boy crying for his ex-girlfriend to save him. And that's it!
I'm going under in this time, I fear there's no one to save me.
Okay, how am I supposed to feel bad for him? I've always hated the trope of women needing to save some douchey guy or vice versa. But the main problem is that Lewis does not come off as sympathetic or sincere in his performance, especially with that whine of his.
It's a nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all.
Fiddle! Seriously, he's starting to sound like the guy from Hinder. At least Austin Winkler got past the denial stage of his grief. With that context, this song is basically sung from the perspective of some drunk fat ass who's still jacking off to his ex. That's not emotional. I know I just criticized Dean Lewis for being too depressing, but at least he knows he needs to move on and isn't wailing like a man-child. Also, what's this whole thing about being someone she loved? The way you phrase it, it seems like you're just sad because you're no longer her boy toy.
I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you love.
I was getting used to being your lay.
And outside the club.
Oh god, what the f was that? Did you get your balls chopped off or something? I've heard wails of grief, but that was like an animal being castrated. Sing with the diaphragm, not the throat. You'd actually know that if you were a decent singer. Now that we're heading into the 2020s, I'm just gonna say it. Someone You Loved is one of the worst hit songs of the entire 2010s. That's right, I'm putting him in the same territory as Meghan Trainor. And you know what? F it. I'd rather listen to 6ix9ine before I listen to another Lewis Capaldi track. Oh yeah, I went there. I haven't officially looked at every hit song of the decade, but off the top of my head, I can't think of one that was decidedly more torturous than this. If America has any decency, please let this song sink like a rock and minimize the collateral damage it's already caused.
I was getting kinda used to being someone you loved.
Well, those are my top 10 worst hit songs of 2019. I can't believe this video is over, because it isn't. The reason I didn't put this as my number one worst song is because I barely consider this a song to begin with. It's a lazy, failed attempt at doing something for a supposedly good cause. And remember when I got shocked by Halsey's inclusion in the Video for Good category? That wasn't the only one. The other was Lil Dicky.
We love the earth, it is our
Oh, how quickly this has already been forgotten. Pretty much everyone else in the world has torn into this by now, so I'm just gonna summarize the main points. It sounds like shit, and Lil Dicky is not funny. Yeah, that's honestly really it. Unless you want me to demonstrate more.
I'm a baboon. I'm like a man, just less advanced, and my anus is huge.
Har har?
How's it going? I'm a cow. You drink milk from my tits.
Is that a new revelation? I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with basic mammal anatomy, right? Then again, this is America we're talking about.
I'm a fat fucking pig.
I'm a common fungus.
No, Haley Steinfeld, not you too! God damn it, Dicky, now you're dragging talented people down with you. If you're gonna make a charity single, make it about why the Earth should be saved, or at least write better punchlines. Instead, you're giving more reasons as to why the Earth should perish.
I'm a marijuana plant, I can get you fucked up.
And I'm Kanye West.
We love the...
Eh, I'm indifferent.
We love the tiny.
We forgive you, Germany.
We forgive you, Germany? The war was 74 years ago! This song fails on every level. You know the score, and let this train wreck of a mess rotten the hell it deserves. Damn, this makes We Are the World 2010 sound like classical jazz. Hopefully, I don't need to see another instance in which Haley Steinfeld is dragged down by a song that should have been aborted. It would be even worse if it sampled one of my least favorite songs of all time.
As we go on, we remember.
I'm done. Once again, I'm Mr. 96. If you want to see more pop reviews, click the subscribe button below and tap that bell to be notified when I drop a new episode. The top 10 best hit songs of 2019 are coming later this month, so thank you for watching my annual countdown. Pop songs may come in numbers, but there's only one, 96.